And so Dumdum, he rides into Mecca. And he, before he arrives into Mecca, he does something that they would do because to make a real noise, he cuts the ears of his camels and his camel, and he cuts the nose of his camel. And as the camel, when obviously if you're going to hurt the camel is screaming. It's in pain and it's screaming. And as Dum Dum rides into Mecca and the camel is making this noise, rah, rah, and it's screaming these noises. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik wa sallam alayhi. And as it's screaming and it's making these noises, the people of Quraysh, they start to gather. What is happening? What is happening? And they see the camel and it is bleeding and its ears are bleeding and it's making these noises. And Dum Dum, he turns around so that he sat with his back towards the head of the camel and he's facing the and he's facing the people now as they all start to gather around the back of the camel. And he starts saying to them, oh, woe to you, O people of Quraysh. Oh, Muhammad has taken your caravan. You have nothing left. He has taken all of your goods. He has left you poor and he has left you with nothing. He has taken everything, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And so now the Quraysh, who were thinking, what are we going to do? Everything that we have has been taken. Abu Jahl, he stands up and he says, will we let him do this to us? No, we will attack him. And we will attack him in the worst possible way. And we will not leave any one of them alive. And we will take them all. And so they begin now. And Abu Jahl now begins and he starts to say, not a one of you will stay behind. So even those who didn't want to fight the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Jahl doesn't give even them a choice. Even they are forced, the likes of Sayyidina Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sayyidina Atiq ibn Abi Talib, the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even those Abu Bakhtari, who is a very ethical man, even though he's not a Muslim and he doesn't want to fight the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are not given a choice. Abu Jahl says, no, you will all come. Not a man will be left behind. And they are all, some are forced to come out and others, they go out wanting to fight. Yes, we will fight. And the Quraysh, they raise an army of 1,000 strong, 1,000 soldiers. And Sufyan ibn Amr, who was the person who had the armor and the swords, and he would trade in weapons, he starts handing out weapons to everybody. And so they come out with the best swords and the best shields and the best armor. And over 300 of them are riding war horses, horses that are trained to fight. And they come out looking to fight and looking to go to war with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, back in Medina, the scouts have come back and they have said, Ya Rasulullah, we found the tracks of Abu Sufyan's caravan. And this is where it is going to be. And Ya Rasulullah, it is going to travel past Badr at this time. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says to the companions, come, let's go. Let's take what belongs to us from the caravan. And so they set out, and they don't set out to go to war. They set out, and some of them have only a branch to fight. And they don't set out with armor. And 313 men come forward. And some children also come forward. And some of the children, they hide. And Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, he says, I saw my brother, and my brother was little. And he was hiding behind the horses. And I said to him, I said, why are you hiding? And he said, I hide because I want to go and fight with you. I want to fight at Badr with you. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik wa sallam alayhi. I want to fight at Badr with you, but I'm scared that if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if he is to see me, he will send me home. And so he would hide, and so as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as they get a little bit further out from Badr, from Medina, as they get a little bit further out, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he lines up all the soldiers, and as all the soldiers are lined up, he calls forward the children, come forward. And as the children come forward, like, Ya Rasulullah, we want to fight. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, Nah, you are too young. You are too young. But you see the beauty. And of you kids who are sat here today who are listening, we know you are the people of Jannah already. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik wa sallu alayhi. But we know that the love that you have for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's the purest kind of love. It's the kind of love that these kids had. Ya Rasulullah, we want to fight. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to them, he says, no, he says, you are too young. The time will come for you. And so they are sent home. And now as they move forward into the Battle of Badr, as they move forward now, news comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the Quraysh have raised this army. And Ya Rasulullah, you are going forth to fight, you are going forth just to go to the caravan. Just to go to the caravan. You weren't going forth for war. But now the Quraysh has raised this army, Ya Rasulullah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to the companions, tell me what you want to do. And the muhajirun, those who have traveled with the caravan, those who have left their homes as refugees, they say, we want to fight. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, tell me what you want to do. And they say, we want to fight. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, tell me what you want to do. Until those from the Ansar realize, he's not asking the muhajirun. He's not asking those who left their homes. He's asking those of us who were in Medina. Those of us who swore that we would protect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's asking us. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they say, Ya Rasulullah, it is as though you are asking us. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, yes. And they say, Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik wa sallam alayhi, they say, Ya Rasulullah, go forward and do as you will. Do as you will, Ya Rasulullah. For we will follow you in whatever you do. If you want to fight, we will fight. If you want to go to the soldiers, we will go to the soldiers. If you want to go to the caravan, we will go to the caravan. We will not be like the people of Musa alayhi salam that said, you go forward and fight with Allah and we will sit back. We will not be like that, Ya Rasulullah. We will fight. But here I want to pause a minute because I want us to see he is the Prophet of God. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, over and over again, Allah tells us in the Quran, obey me, obey him. Over and over again, we are told, you obey the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, he could have commanded. He could have said to them, this is what we're going to do. And you're all going to do it. But the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he never used his authority, his power, to make people do that which they didn't want to do if it wasn't a command of Allah. A command of Allah is a command of Allah. But this, that was their choice. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, always honored and respected those around him. And even in this war, at this time, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could have said to them, this is a war that is going to secure Islam forever. So we are going to fight it. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he doesn't issue the command. He honors them with the choice. What do you wish to do? And they come back and they say, Ya Rasulullah, we will fight. And this pleases the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so they move forward into the battle. And as they move forward into the battle, Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, he sees that before they go into into the battle. There is a place before the battlefield. And he says, Ya Rasulullah, let me build for you a shelter over here. And in this shelter, Ya Rasulullah, you can, and you can stay in the shelter, Ya Rasulullah. And if you, if we lose this battle, if we lose this battle, Ya Rasulullah, that you can get, go back to Medina, because we will defend you between now, between them coming to you and you, between Medina. So we will be in between them. We will stand here, Ya Rasulullah. And you can, Ya Rasulullah, get to Medina. And people there will defend you. And so they build a shelter. And the companions, they build a shelter. And everybody goes to sleep. And Sayyidina Ali karamallahu wajhu, he says, we all slept. And we slept a really nice sleep. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't sleep all night. All night, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood in prayer. Ya Allah. Ya Allah, my companions, Ya Allah, praying for the companions, showing the love and the mercy that he has for those who follow him. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq would say that he prayed so much that his feet swelled up. And he stands and he prays, and he stands and he prays, and he stands and he prays, and the sun rises. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said that he prayed and he prayed and he prayed, and he raised his hands and he would pray and pray and pray, and slowly his rida falls off his shoulder. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, who can't bear to watch the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam cry so in so much pain for his, the people who loved him, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq places his rida back on his shoulder and he hugs him from behind and he says, enough, Ya Rasulullah, Allah has heard your prayers. Because Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he knows that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going through so much just for his companions. Can you stand all night? Can you stand all night? Even if you're praying for those who you love desperately, eventually you will sit. You will get tired. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stands all night in prayer. Why? For you and me. For those companions who are going to send, who are going to protect Islam so that you and I can say the Shahada. Because he loves them and he does not wish for them to be hurt, but he also wants for Islam to continue so that you and I may sit here today and speak about the beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so, and then the battle starts. And Sayyidina Ali karamallahu wajhu, he says, I go into battle and I'm in the middle of battle and I have a question I need to ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I leave the battle. And I run to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he's in prayer. And so I go back to the battle because I don't want to interrupt him. And I'm in the middle of battle, and then the question comes back to me again, and I run back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I say to the Prophet, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's in prayer. And then I go back into the battle, and I'm fighting in the battle, and then I come back, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is still in prayer. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he causes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is praying, and he closes his eyes. And sleep overcomes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as he closes his eyes, and just for a moment, and then he opens his eyes, and he has a huge smile on his face. And he says, Ya Abu Bakr, success is guaranteed. Here is Jibra'il alayhi salam leading the angels. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has answered the prayers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and sent the angel Jibra'il alayhi salam down with the army of angels to fight in Badr with the companions. So I want to pause for a minute again. Because imagine you're in a football game. You're going to send your best player out onto the battlefield, right? You're going to send your best player out onto the football pitch because you want to win. So you're going to send the best one out. or you're in a quiz. You're going to make sure that the brainiest of you, the one who's the got the most knowledge, is in that quiz fighting. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam understands it's not about the strongest. It's not about the bravest. It's about Allah. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best soldier they have. If they're going to win the battle because of the best soldier, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam should have been on the battlefield. But he sallallahu alaihi wasallam is praying because he knows that victory is from Allah. So over and over again, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam shows us that really what you need to have is tawakkal upon Allah, is faith in Allah. You go to Allah. When it all happens, when all the problems hit, when you're in difficulty, you raise your hands. You go to Allah. And Allah, He sent the angels. And so they go into battle. And now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he puts on his armor, he puts on his helmet, and he comes out onto the battlefield. And remember, this is 1,000 soldiers. They've got armor, they've got swords, they've got shields. One of the companions, he says, I was fighting with my sword, and the sword of the disbeliever, he hit my sword, and my sword snapped in two. So I ran to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and I said, Ya Rasulullah, my sword snapped in two. And the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, he picked up a twig from the tree and he said, here, take this. And as I looked at the twig, it turned into a sword, and I ran into the battle and I began to fight with this sword. But this is what you see with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions. Their confidence in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so much that they run into battle with a twig. But Sayyidina Ali, when the Prophet ﷺ goes into the battle, Sayyidina Ali, karamallahu wajhu, he was so strong, he had the strength, it was said, of 40 men. He was the soldier of soldiers. That was his job. He said in the Battle of Badr, when it got too much for us and we were scared and the soldiers were coming and we didn't know what to do, we would hide behind the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was always, Sayyidina Ali said, he was always in the where the battle was the fiercest, where it was the hardest, where the companions, where the polytheists were fighting the most. That's where we would find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But in all the battles that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam fought, we only have an account of one person killed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we're going to talk about him in a minute when we're talking about Uhud, and he's called Ibn Qaymiyyah. And Ibn Qaymiyyah is the only person that we know dies as a result of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what's he doing in the middle of the battlefield where the fighting is at its greatest? What is he doing, sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He's just defending people. He's just making sure, he's just fighting with his sword, and he's just making sure that nobody gets killed. He's protecting life. Because even in battles, the Prophet ﷺ, every single battle he fought was about protecting life. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah's wrath, his anger is great against one who is killed by the messengers. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, out of his mercy, rahmatul lil alameen, even though these are enemies of Allah, even though these are people who fight the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he does not wish for Allah's wrath to be great against them. He does not wish for Allah's anger to be great against them. And so he does not kill them, even though he could. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not. Because for them to die at his sword, Allah's anger would be great. And he does not wish for that. So he shows even how he has mercy to the enemies. His mercy, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, extends even to the enemies. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Now we see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so his bravery and his courage is so great that he's always in the middle. His bravery and courage is so great that in a different battle, at the Battle of Hunain, this takes place way later after the after Fatal Makkah, close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's passing from this life. At the Battle of Hunain, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is on a donkey. He's going into battle on a donkey. Most of us wouldn't ride to the supermarket in a donkey. On a donkey, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is riding a donkey into battle. What a blessed donkey that was. And in the and the Battle of Hunain, the Hawazin, the enemy, they lay an ambush. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they're going to meet at Hunain. That's the plan. But they come before and they surround the mountains and they put their archers onto the mountains. And so as the army of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is coming through the mountain pass, as it's coming through the valley between the two mountains, the archers now, they begin to shoot the arrows down. And the Muslims, they run, and non-Muslims, this is actually an army that where the non-Muslims of the Quraysh fight alongside the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they all run. And they run to try and find cover because the arrows are coming down from the heights of the mountains. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is stood on his donkey and he wants to charge. He wants to run on his donkey. He wants to like, and he's pushing his donkey forward. And he's and Sayyidina Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, his uncle and his cousin Abu Sufyan, not Sayyidina Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harb, that's a different Abu Sufyan. His cousin Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harith, they're stood and they're pulling at the reins of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's donkey, trying to pull him back. Ya Rasulullah, no, don't go. Ya Rasulullah, no, 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 don't go. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's wanting to charge. All his soldiers have gone. This is the bravery of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's not like, he doesn't look, I'm just on a donkey. There's hundreds of archers here, there's arrows flying down, I'm going to get killed, they're going to shoot me with arrows, I'm going to get hurt. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam, noble character, his courage is beyond compare. Not a single person has the kind of courage that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has. He would go into situations knowing full well that they're trying to kill me, they're trying to hurt me. And he sallallahu alaihi wasallam would walk with no fear. No fear. He had courage. And where is that courage? Where is its roots? Its roots, tawakkul Allah. My Allah, I have faith in Allah. Whatever will happen, will happen. Whatever Allah is going to protect me from, Allah will protect me from. Whatever Allah intends to happen is going to happen no matter what. So I will be courageous. And I will do what is right. So rewinding back to Badr, coming back from Hunain, back to Badr. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik wa sallam. And so we see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the Battle of Badr, and the angels and the companions now, they are fighting. And this 1,000-strong army of the Quraysh, they realize we can't win. And these two, and Sayyidina Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, he's wonderful, so wonderful. He says, as we go into battle, I look on one side of me and I see Ibn Afra, one of the sons of Afra. And I look down and I see Ibn Afra. And then I look down and on the other side of me, I see Ibn Afra. So both brothers, and they're young, they're the youth, they're not fully grown, but they're little. And said that Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, he says, you know, in my head, I'm thinking, I really want, like, I want to be surrounded by big, strong men. I don't want to be surrounded by a bit little youth. If the fighting gets really tough, I want big, strong men to defend me. And he says, as I'm thinking this, one of them, like, he elbows me and he says, uncle, uncle. And I look at him and I say, what, like, what? And he says to me, he says, oh, uncle, do you know what Abu Jahl looks like? Do you know Abu Jahl? And I said to him, I said, yeah, I know Abu Jahl. What do you want with Abu Jahl? And he says, I hear he insults the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I want to kill him. And I'm like thinking, well, look at the bravery of this one. Because Abu Jahl, he was said to be 7.5, 8 feet tall. He was a huge man. His neck was the size of a man's thigh. He was huge. And so Sayyidina Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, he's like thinking, whoa, look at the bravery of him. And then as I'm thinking about the bravery of this one, I get the other brother, he elbows me. Uncle. And I say, what do you want? And he says, do you know Abu Jahl? And I'm like, yeah, what do you want with Abu Jahl? He says, I've heard he says awful things about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I want to kill him. And I'm like looking down at these two youths, and I'm thinking, wow, how brave they are. And then as the battle goes on, Sayyidina Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, he sees Abu Jahl on a horse. And he says, hey, young one, you know the one that you're looking for? That's him over there. And I think that they're going to look at him and they're going to think, oh no, he's really big. Like he's on a horse and he's a really big man. And they see him. As soon as I say it, they start running. And they get to Abu Jahl. And their sword doesn't even reach Abu Jahl because he's on a horse. Their swords are just reaching the feet of Abu Jahl. They don't even get to Abu Jahl because they're so little and he's on a horse. And so they now start attacking until Abu Jahl, he falls off the horse. And then they start attacking Abu Jahl. And then when they've attacked Abu Jahl and Abu Jahl's on the ground, they run to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they get to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they say, Ya Rasulullah. And the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, he's in the middle of a battle. There are soldiers, people are trying to kill him. There is fighting going on. You know, when you go to your mum and she's cooking and she's like, I'm cooking. Could you just leave me alone for a minute? I've got to finish this. I'm just cooking. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he leaves the battle. He says, yes. He answers. He honors. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam shows that even these youth, I will take time for you. And this is why when we say assalamu alaykum ya Rasulullah, we know that he's going to take time for us. And he's going to say, wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu ya Bano. Ameen ya Rabbi. He's going to take time for us. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And he says, yes. And they say, Ya Rasulullah, I killed Abu Jahl. And the other brother says, no, I killed Abu Jahl. And then the one, no, I killed him. No, I killed him. So the brothers are fighting now. I killed him. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he laughs. And he says to them, he says, did you wipe the blood from your swords? And they say, no, Ya Rasulullah, look, I still got his blood on my sword. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, then you both killed him. And you were helped by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And actually it was Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud who takes the final breaths of Sayyidina Abu Jahl. Well, we might not get to that actually just because of time, because I want to get to Uhud too. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik wa sallam alayhi. So then the victory is resounding. And they win. And the army and the rest of the army, when they realize of the Quraysh, when they realize we're just losing, we can't, you know, there's nothing we can do. They start running. One runs, second runs, third runs, fourth runs, until hundreds of them start running. And 70 of them are captured. And 70 of them are killed. And as they're taking the Quraysh, as they enter into Medina now, 3 days after the Battle of Badr, as they enter into Medina, the Medinans, they come out and they've heard news. Wow, you won. Oh, we didn't even, this was amazing. And they come out and the one of the companions called Salama ibn Salama, he's on the horse. And he says, hey, what are you congratulating us for? They were just old, bald men. They were like camels waiting for the slaughter. And we went in and we slaughtered them. Because he's really high and he's pumped. And he's like, hey, we were so strong. We did, no worries. They were. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he smiles and he says, oh, son of my brother, actually, they were the nobles and the dignitaries of the Quraysh. Even in victory, the Prophet wasallam, he does not insult. He does not dishonor even his enemy. He, wasallam, he wins with grace. He doesn't even in victory, he wasallam, does not take the opportunity now to return back the hundreds of insults that they have tried to give to him. Because that's not who is his teacher. He wasallam, is noble in character. And the nobility of his character is such that he will not go down to that level. When somebody says something bad to us, we want to say something bad to them. When somebody hurts us, we want to hurt them. The Prophet ﷺ, he was forbearing. And his character of hilm, this character of when you were bad to him, he's better to you. When you're worse to him, he's even better to you. Even in war, even those who sought to kill him, he ﷺ recognized that they were the nobles and the dignitaries of their people. And then when he gets back from Badr, everybody is celebrating victory. Everybody is celebrating victory. The Prophet ﷺ returns back, and as he's returning back, Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan is smoothing the grave of Sayyidina Ruqayya. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, arrives back into Medina to the news that his beloved daughter Sayyidina Ruqayya has passed away. The day that all of Medina celebrates, the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, has the grief of the sadness of his daughter. Of his beautiful, blessed daughter passing away. But the Prophet ﷺ doesn't expect everybody else's joy at the victory of Badr to end because he is grieving. And he ﷺ does not complain once. He does not, Ya Allah, we just had victory. You took my daughter right now. Not once. Because the Prophet ﷺ shows us, when you have noble character, the will of Allah is something you accept. You grieve, you have sadness, but everything, alhamdulillah wa shukrulillah. Alhamdulillah. Yes. Yes, yes, the Prophet's daughter, the Prophet ﷺ, buries every single one of his children except Sayyidina Fatima. Yeah, but the Prophet ﷺ never complained. He ﷺ has a really difficult life. He has a very tough life. Okay. So let's go on to the Battle of Uhud. Now, I know Sophia also posted this. She posted, if you guys have questions, I do want to take time for questions. But because I don't see any questions in the box right now, I'm going to carry on into the Battle of Uhud. But if you have questions about Badr, you have questions, or you even want to, like, even have comments, you know, I love it when you guys have comments. If you have comments, put them down into the chat box. I have the chat box open on my screen so I can see it as you're coming. And if there's a moment in the story, I can pause and I can address them. But at the end, inshallah, I will. So we're going to take another maybe 15 to 20 minutes. We'll talk about Ahad, and then we'll stop at about 10 past the hour. And then we'll have another 20 minutes for questions. If you guys have questions and comments and thoughts, I really want to hear from you guys. And you guys can put your mics on as well and ask me questions and we can talk. So after the Battle of Badr, Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik wa sallam alayhi. A man called Ibn Qaymiyyah, who was from the Quraysh, and he swears an oath. And in his oath, he swears that I am going to repay Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the defeat of Badr. And so he now, Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik wa sallam alayhi, this man, Ibn Qaymiyyah, he decides, I'm going to repay him. I'm going to kill him. Now, Ad-Badr, Sayyid Abu Sufyan, before his Islam, he says to the Prophet ﷺ, we will meet in a year's time at Uhud. And so they plan now the battle. The next battle is planned. And Ibn Gaymiyyah, he goes home. And he begins to raise these two war horses. And he begins to raise these two war horses. And he trains them to fight. And he trains them to go to war. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik wa sallam. And he begins to plan how he's going to attack the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And for a whole year, all he does now is plan to attack the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he gets these horses ready, and this horse is ready to run through all of the soldiers, because he's training it and he's feeding it the things that he needs to, and he's training it in war. And so they get to the Battle of Uhud. Now, when Uhud happens, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, arranges for archers to sit on be on a mountain, and he says to them, he says, do not leave this mountain. You continue to throw arrows and you prevent the armies from coming to us. And so the archers are set, and now the battle takes place, and the Muslims are winning. They are victorious. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik wa sallam alayhi. And they begin to, the Quraysh now, they begin to be pushed back, and the army are victorious. Now in the army are some of the soldiers that hadn't got to Badr. And so they didn't get the war booty of Badr. And now as the army begin to, as the Quraysh begin to back off and the Muslim army begin to push them forward, and they realize that, okay, no, we're winning. Some of the Muslim army, they now rush to try and start gathering the swords and the armor and the things that the people who are going to win, they're going to be able to collect. And the soldiers who are on the mountain, they see this. Oh, look, we're winning. Look, they're getting the war booty. Now, Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid, before his Islam, he is a soldier in the Quraysh's army. He's a commander. He's leading the army. And he has an entire battalion of soldiers on horses. And they're hiding behind the mountain. So the archers can't see them, but they can see the archers. And this huge battalion is hiding. And they're waiting for the archers to move so that they can come around the mountain and attack the Muslim army from behind. When the archers on the mountain, they see, look, we're winning. We can go down now. We're winning. And we can start collecting. And we can start collecting the booty from the war. We can go. Some of the soldiers said, no, no. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, don't leave. But they say, no, no, we're winning, we're winning. It's okay, we've won. Don't worry about it. We're good, we've won. And they race down. Now, as Khalid ibn Walid, he sees the archers leave. He knows that now there's nobody to shoot arrows on his battalion. And so he orders his battalion to come forward. And so now this army of soldiers, army of on horses, they come around the mountain. And the Muslim army that thought they had won, that are facing this direction, all of a sudden, they start getting attacked from behind and they don't know what's happening. But so, and as they get attacked from behind and all of these soldiers start attacking them, and the Quraysh from the front, they see, yes, our friends from the back have come. They start attacking from the front. And now the Muslim army is being attacked from all sides, and they start to run. And they start to try and get to shelter and try and get to safety. And those around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they continue to fight. And some of them, they fall and say, the Nusayba, may Allah be pleased with her. She sees the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she sees that those around him have fallen. And so she grabs a sword from one of the enemies, and she runs, and she says she grabs a sword and she grabs a spear, and she runs to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she stands in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she begins to attack all of those who are trying to attack the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, he says that wherever I looked, I saw Nusayba. She's attacking, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he looks to his right and say that Nusayba is there. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he looks to his left and say that Nusayba is there. And in wars later on, he sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would say, just give me one of Nusayba. Just one of Nusayba. That'll be enough. Because she was everywhere. She just fought and fought. Now Ibn Qaymiyyah, he's not been fighting. He's been waiting. I'm going to wait to see when I got a chance to get to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And Ibn Qaymiyyah, when he sees the defense of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he sees the soldiers fall and the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, fighting, and Sayyidina Nusayba fighting, and Sayyidina Talha ibn Ubaidullah fighting, and he sees that there's only two or three people around the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now, and Sayyidina Ali karamallahu wajhu also says that I was there, Ibn Qaymiyyah, he rides his horse and he rides straight for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as he gets to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wasallam, he begins to strike. And he strikes Sayyidina Nusayba. And he strikes Sayyidina Nusayba, so he strikes her shoulder and he injures her. And he carries on, he gets to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and as he gets to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he strikes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he hits the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the helmet of the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, actually was his left cheek. The Prophet of the helmet of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he hits the helmet. His sword hits the helmet, and the helmet goes into the cheek of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it bounces. And then his sword hits the shoulder of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the blessed tooth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is knocked out. It's shaheed. And the helmet of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is in the cheek, is in his cheek, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, when Ibn Qaymiyyah says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I swear I will kill you at Badr, he's actually a prisoner of war. And when he's released, when his ransom is come and he's released from Medina, that's when he makes this threat. He says, I swear I will kill you. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, no, by Allah, I will kill you. And so when his sword hits the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then he turns around and he comes back in to attack the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, just moves out of the way. And the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, has a stick in his hand. And he reaches up with the stick, and Ibn Qaymiyyah is scratched over here. And as he's scratched, Ibn Qaymiyyah grabs hold of his scratch, and it's just a scratch. And he grabs hold of the scratch, and he races back to where the Quraysh are, where the injured of the Quraysh are. And the injured of the Quraysh, you know, some have like their arms are hurt, and they're dying, and oh, they're like, you know, their legs have been cut, and you know, they're like arrows are in them. And he runs in. And he's on his horse, and he's riding his horse, and he's like, Muhammad has killed me, Muhammad has killed me, Muhammad has killed me, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And they look at him, and as he comes in, he's shouting, and he's making all this noise, he's killed me, he's killed me, he's killed me. And their nurses and the people who were there to try and help the injured, they're like looking at him like, what can we do, what can we do, where are you hurt? You're not hurt. There's nothing on you. There's no sword wound. There's no arrow shots. What do you mean he's killed you? And he's like, no, by God. Muhammad said he would kill me, and he never lies. and he scratched me with his stick, so he has killed me. So I want to take a moment right there. And I want us to see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his trustworthiness, his truthfulness was so much that even his enemies, even those who wanted to kill him, they knew that the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, does not lie. So when he says, no, by Allah, I will kill you, this is the truth. He will kill me. So even though if you and I were scratched by something, if you were scratched and you went to your mum and you said, ow, I'm scratched, she'd say, it's just a scratch. Don't worry, you're fine. But Ibn Gaymiyyah, even though it's just a scratch, he knows that the Prophet ﷺ said he was going to kill me, and I am now scratched, and he did it, so I am going to die. Because he has so much, he knows the Prophet ﷺ, he has so much trust in the truth of the Prophet ﷺ. And Ibn Gaymiyyah does die from that scratch. It becomes infected and he dies. The only person we know that is killed at the hands of the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, said, Allah's anger is great against one that is killed by the Prophet. So Ibn Gaymiyyah, Allah's anger is great against him. So going back to Sayyidina Nusayba and Sayyidina Talha ibn Ubaidullah. So now they're defending the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is injured, and Sayyidina Nusayba is injured, and the Prophet and Sayyidina Nusayba, her son gets injured, Umair gets injured, and Sayyidina Nusayba, when she sees her son injured, she runs to him and she wraps up his injury and she says to him, okay, get up, fight. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says to her, Umair, is there not anything that you will not withstand? And Sayyidina Nusayba, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would speak of Sayyidina Nusayba, and later when she speaks to him about her shoulder, and she says, Ya Rasulullah, am I of the martyrs? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, indeed, you are of the martyrs. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he's injured now, and Sayyidah Fatima, when she hears that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is injured, Sayyidah Fatima rushes into the battlefield to try and help the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and may Allah's peace and blessings be upon her. And Sayyidina Talha ibn Ubaidullah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he sees the army now and they're running because the Quraysh are attacking from both sides, the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, knowing that if the enemy hears his voice, the enemy is going to attack. Despite that, he wants to make sure that the Muslim army is given the strength that they need from his voice. And so he says, I am the Prophet of Allah. And as they hear this, the army come back. But when they hear this, the Quraysh, who are closer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they all start to shoot arrows at him. And it is said that Sayyidina Talha ibn Ubaidullah, he now tries to protect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Sayyidina Nusayba, she has over 12 or 13 spear wounds and sword wounds. She's injured over 12 or 13 places by spears and swords. And Sayyidina Talha ibn Ubaidullah is in 32 places, he is injured. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say of Sayyidina Talha, he would say, if anybody wants to see a walking martyr, look at Talha ibn Ubaidullah. And again, you see, we talk about noble characteristics. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, if you don't thank people, you don't thank Allah. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, gives praise, gives thanks to those who give him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who do for him, who do good for him. He, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, makes sure that they are honored, that they are thanked, that they are appreciated, that those around them know. Just give me one of Nusayba. If you want to see a walking martyr, look at Talha ibn Ubaidullah. So we see that he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he thanks. But he's also protective. He also protects those who are beloved to him. Sayyidah Baraka Ayman, the Abyssinian ex-slave, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam freed her. She was a slave and she was the woman who raised the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would call her my mother after my mother. And she was Abyssinian. Today, what we would call Ethiopia or Sudan or Oman or Eritrea. And said, Baraka Ayman, she would go to the battlefield and she would nurse the sick. Those who were injured, she would help them. But she was so concerned about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my son. She would constantly watch for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he was at the battle, what was going on, was he safe, is he okay? Just like your mums will always watch out for you, just like your dads will always watch out for you. And say the Baraka Ayman, she's watching the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as she sees the army spread out, say the Baraka Ayman, she's scared for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So she runs and she grabs a sword and she's waving it around like this, like trying to make sure that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is protected. And a man called Hibban ibn Araqa, he shoots an arrow from the Quraysh at Sayyidah Baraka Ayman. And it hits her. And as Sayyidah Baraka Ayman is hit by the arrow, and she's thrown off her feet. And as she's thrown off her feet, her dress from her legs, it's raised a little bit. And Hibban ibn Araqa, he laughs. He starts to laugh, and this angers the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You laughed at my mother. And he gives Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Waqqas an arrow, and the arrow doesn't have a top to it. It's broken. The head of the arrow, it's broken. And he says to Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Waqqas, he says, shoot the arrow. And Hibban ibn Araqa is hit with the arrow. And as he's hit and he falls and he dies and his clothing's are lifted, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Allah returned to you what you did to the mother of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Waqqas, he says, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says to him, he says, Ya Sa'd, repel the Quraysh, because the Quraysh have started to attack. And Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Waqqas, he says, with what? And he goes to his back and he pulls out, and he realizes there's another arrow. And it's the same arrow as the one he just shot. And he shoots it and he thinks, I don't have any arrows left. And he reaches to his back and he has another arrow. And it's the same arrow as the one he just shot. And he shoots it. And he says, I just kept shooting and I kept using the same arrow that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had given me. And even after he dies, his children have that same arrow. The arrow that has no head. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with his own blessed hands had given. But you see, with noble character, you protect those. You protect your parents. You protect the weak. You protect the vulnerable. You stand for truth, for justice, for right. And you see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in war stand, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then, when the Battle of Uhud ends, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stands at the mountain. Now, after the Battle of Uhud, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is killed. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are killed. This is the day of Uhud, is a day that is deeply sad for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But at the Battle of Uhud, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after the Quraysh have left, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is said with the companions, he stands at the base of the mountain, and he raises his hands. And he says to the companions, straighten your lines so that I may pray to my Lord. And they all straighten their lines. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Ya Allah, all thanks is yours. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All thanks is to you. Ya Allah, there is no holding back of what you grant and no giving of what you hold back. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then makes a long dua on the Battle of Uhud, thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and acknowledging that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is supreme. Because what did we say? Everything that we see of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, its roots are where? In taqwa of Allah. Knowing that whatever Allah is going to make happen is going to happen. And whatever Allah is going to protect you from, Allah is going to protect you from. And there is nothing that anybody can do that will make happen what Allah doesn't allow or prevent happen what Allah has willed. Nothing. And we see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in every step of his wars, him show you how to have noble character with Allah and with those around you. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, we're going to stop there. That was a lot of talking. Very early in the morning for me to talk this much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bano. It was lovely. And I open the floor for anyone who wants to give it.
Assalamualaikum, Ustaza. That was a lovely story to hear. And everything that you spoke, just like, it just stirs your heart to hear such touching stories from his character. And I think one question I wanted to know, like, mainly was like, how was this character, how was his character developed throughout his years for him to be that courageous and to be that balanced and composed throughout something that is so stressful? Because I feel like none of us could ever, it's difficult to be that way. So I'm just curious, how has the character developed throughout his years?
So we see with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, obviously we know that he sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, he is taught by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's in the company of Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam and Sayyidina Israfil alayhi salam. So so we obviously we know that there is character that is that is being developed by that companionship. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, it is said that in his youth he takes from every, like, different parts of his character, you can see them really developing in different stages. So, for example, with Sayyidah Halima, it was said that her hilm, her forbearance, this ability to do good when somebody did bad to you, these were things that, you know, she actually gives to him through her milk. But at, you know, his character sallallahu alaihi wasallam was considered to be one of his greatest miracles, and actually it was even said to be was given as signs in the Torah and in the Injil and in the books of the previous prophets. His character was given as a sign of his prophecy sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But you see, from Sayyidah Halima, and the time that he spends in the desert and the time that he spends, you know, with the Banu Sa'd, this is a time when he's really developing that control and that ability to respond to what are very extreme circumstances, circumstances of drought, circumstances of danger, of working with Allahumma salli wa sallam mubarak wa sallam alayhi, of, you know, abductions were very common at that time, people taking children and things like that. Tribal raids were also common. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is living through that. Then you see his time with his mother, may Allah be pleased with her, Sayyidah Amina. And it is said that this is a period of aman, of calm, of tranquility, of ease. And this is a time where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is learning how to really calm his character, of calming those emotions, you know. And as kids, as kids, we have this, those big emotions, and learning how to calm them, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then with Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib, his next 2 years under the guardianship of Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib, he's learning leadership and how to mediate and how to help when there's arguments and fights, and how to settle those arguments and settle those fights, both at a individual level and at big tribal levels where tribes are going to go to war with one another. Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib was considered to be one who brought people together. And so you see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam begin to place these values of justice and of of peace and of chivalry and bravery in these ways. And then, of course, you have, you know, the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't act except that Allah, and ultimately this is the reality of it, Allah tells us he doesn't act of his own volition. He doesn't speak except that Allah guides him. And so we see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his showing us noble character and his putting these things in play is really all designed as lessons for us. Even in the circumstances that he's put in, it's all designed as, okay, when you're put in these circumstances, this is how you must react. And of course, we understand that he is the Prophet. And he does have Sayyidina Jibreel as a companion. And Allah is guiding his words, which is why we are given the companions to show us that you can develop these characteristics. And there are some characteristics that will be natural to you and some that will be less natural to you. And that's okay too. And I'll just give you a real quick example of that. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, after the Battle of Badr, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he says, Ya Rasulullah, these are our brothers and the children of our brothers. And so let's not execute them. Let's set them up and give them, let's have them teach our children and have them ransomed. And then they can return to their people. And said Umar ibn al-Khattab, he says, Ya Rasulullah, they are your enemies. Let's execute them all. You know, and he was like very fast with his sword. Bring out his sword. Ya Rasulullah, give me permission to cut off their heads. And so Allah, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he smiled. And he said to them, he said, Ya Abu Bakr, he said, you know, every person has a character. And your character, the example of that, is the example of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, when Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam said, Ya Allah, if you forgive them, they are your slaves. And your example is of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, who prayed for his people. And then he says to Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, he says, Ya Umar, your example is of Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam, who asked Allah, Ya Allah, do not leave from amongst them a disbeliever upon this earth. And your example is of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, that if you were to punish them, Ya Rasulullah, like you punish them. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam acknowledges, just as you just said, it is difficult. You know, your character, we are not expected to be the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him's manifestation of his characters. We are expected to try in the recognition that we have been created with things that will be easy for us. So for some of us, it's easy to be generous. For some of us, it's easy to be gentle. For some of us, it's easy to be just. And so we know that we have certain characteristics that are easy. And then those other things that are not so easy, we're going to try. We're going to try. If we're somebody who's about justice, we're going to try to be more merciful. If we're somebody who's about generous, but you know, we lose our temper, we're going to try to be more patient. It's about that. It's about the trying, really, for us.
Yeah, I see that. Fanal, thank you for sharing your the answer. There was also a question from Nafisa, and her question is that, is this the only time that our Prophet killed a person in Uhud?
Yes, this is actually the only time the Prophet kills anybody. In all of the seerah of the Prophet, he only is responsible for the death of one person, and that is Ibn Qaymiyyah. So not just at Uhud, but at all battles.
Mm-hmm. And another question by Husna. She said, Salam Ustaza, I've got a question. It seems like the Quraysh, they knew all along that Prophet Muhammad speaks nothing but the truth. So I was wondering why, when the Prophet delivered the message of the truth, they denied him and called him a soothsayer, a poet, or a magician.
So you're right, they did. Abu Jahl was actually asked, somebody actually came to Abu Jahl and they said, you know, do you believe what the Prophet says is true? Like, do you believe, like, when he says that he's a prophet, that he's being truthful? And said, and Abu Jahl said, I believe that he is. He has never told a lie. He is absolutely truthful. And so then the man said, so why all the fighting? Why are you fighting him? Why don't you just accept what he says? And Abu Jahl says, because I am Makhzumi. and he is Hashimi. And when the Hashimis bring a poet, we bring a better poet. And when they bring a soldier, we bring a better soldier. Now they've brought a prophet. Where am I supposed to get a prophet from? So we see that actually one of the things about the disbelievers was that their arrogance prevented them from accepting Islam. They were arrogant. And then they were amongst those who, even though they knew it was the truth, they knew that, well, they wanted the pleasures of this life. They wanted the wealth and the power and the strength. So they would say, you know, we know you're truthful, but you want us to sit. So one time, Sayyidina Abu Sufyan, before his Islam, he comes and he actually is willing to listen to the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he gets there and Sayyidina Bilal ibn Rabah is eating, Sayyidina Zayd ibn Harith is eating, Sayyidina, who else was there? I think Sayyidina Mikbad ibn Aswad is there, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is there. And these are all either slaves or ex-slaves, like Mola, people who have been freed from slavery, so they're freed slaves. And Sayyidina Abu Sufyan, and he comes and he looks and he says, you expect me to sit with them? Like, if I'm going to listen to you, you want me to sit with them? Like, they're slaves. I'm like, I'm one of the most notable men in Quraysh. How are you going to expect me to sit with the slaves? And so it wasn't just arrogance. Obviously even that is arrogance, but it was also this thing of, you know, I'm so powerful. I'm so wealthy. How am I going to give up all of my wealth? How am I going to listen to somebody who is an orphan of Banu Hashim, who doesn't have the money that I have? So, you know, for many of them, and, you know, we see this. It's hard for us to think, because we think, oh, well, if we were in the time of the Prophet, we would totally accept him. But how many of us know that, you know, we have to pray? Like, it's time for prayer. It's time for prayer. And we delay it. And we delay it, and we delay it. Oh, no, just 5 more minutes. No, I've got another 5 minutes. It's okay, I'll pray in 5 more minutes. All right, I'll pray. We know we do this, right? We do this. We delay our prayer. We don't listen when, you know, we're in the middle of an argument and we have that voice in our head that's saying, quiet, be quiet, be quiet. And our mouth is going, bum, 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 bum. Stop. So we know, even when we know the truth, even when we know we're not supposed to be doing something, we're still doing it. Because of this world, because we want the power in this world, we want to feel good in this world, we want whatever it is, you know, we want to enjoy ourselves, we want to play the computer game, watch the TV show, whatever it is, we want to carry on doing those things in this world. And that's when we think about the Quraysh, that was their reality. They ultimately knew the truth, but this world and the pleasures of this world, they were stuck on those. And actually, this is one of the definitions of kufr in the tafsir of the Quran. When we read the tafsir of the Quran, one of the definitions of kufr is knowing the truth and refusing to accept it.
Yeah, a simple one, probably, you know, the younger generations can benefit from this as well. What are the 3 things from the story in the context of our life now that we can learn from?
Ooh. 3, you're talking, you want to know for the lesson now, right? I think in our time right now, we have to, I think the first is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when somebody was bad to him, they returned it with good. Okay, and in our life today, we have to begin to start showing people that that is our example. That returning, that doing good to people, even if they're bad to us, because he's our teacher, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he teaches us to do good. And so that would be probably one of the first, for me, one of the most important things that we can take. The second is you stand on truth. It's become so easy for us now to bend the truth, play with the truth, And so, you know, especially if it's for our own advantage. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the reasons even the Quraysh, even when he was their enemy, continued to honor him, was because they understood that he was the truthful one. He was trustworthy. This was so deeply part of who he sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. And then the third really is mercy. Is just to have mercy with ourselves and with those around us. We're to be gentle in the way we speak, in the way we act. Mercy is a huge thing, and we don't have enough of it in the world today.
Wa'iyakum.
So I think inshallah, let's close with a dua. It's been a real pleasure to have you all. Jazakallah khair. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to speak to you all today. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Hamdan yuafi ni'mi yuafi mazidah. Hamdan yuafi ni'mi yuafi mazidah. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Hamdan yuafi ni'mi yuafi mazidah. Ya Allah, all praise is due to you for allowing us to be here, for allowing us to speak about your beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for allowing us and giving us the means to connect hours apart and hundreds and thousands of miles apart from one another. We ask you, Arhamar Rahimeen, that you open up our hearts to the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you open up our act and our obedience to the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We ask that you make us amongst those that are knowers of him and are lovers of him. And we ask you, Arhamar Rahimeen, that you count us by virtue of our loving him amongst those that are beloved to you and beloved to your beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We ask you, Arhamar Rahimeen, that you heal the sick, that you grant relief to those who are in struggles and strife. We ask that you grant ease to those who are oppressed. We ask that you grant freedom to those unfairly incarcerated. We ask that you grant food to the hungry and quench the thirst of the thirsty. And we ask that you protect us and our parents and our loved ones, our spouses, our brothers, our sisters, our children, and our progeny to the end of time, such that neither we nor they are lifted from this earth, except that we have la ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon our lips, upon our limbs, and within our hearts. Ala hadrat al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-Fatiha.
Ameen, ameen, rabbal alameen. Brother Manu, it has been a real pleasure. I really enjoyed the session. I can feel like, you know, I can picture it in my mind how, you know, the situation was definitely not as close as the real one, but at least, you know, trying to understand the context of how they are facing it. I'm very sure everyone else feels the same, and I really hope everyone is safe and keep your guards up. And I'm Afiq with the Peacemeal team, and I do apologize for any shortcomings. Till then, take care. See you soon. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.